write that down, Fumi Saito. Write that down, Fumi Saito.
Patrons, welcome back. I'm Justin Nipper of Fight Game Media. This is Write That Down. I'm here with the one, the only, from Tokyo, Japan, Mr. Fumi Saito. Welcome back.
Hello from Tokyo.
Okay, today is going to be part two. We're going to talk about Genichiro Tenryu again.
Genichiro Tenryu,
So we kind of left off with Tenryu when he, 89, 90, when he's breaking out in All Japan is actually when he ended up leaving All Japan.
After his first huge run, right? Yeah.
So from All Japan, we got a very rare instance where he didn't jump to New Japan, but there was a whole new company that was kind of put on his back in SWS.
Right, SWS, that, Super World Sports, was owned by optical, you know, company called Megane Super. Mm-hmm. And Megane is glasses, right? And it was like, kind of like a bought by your Walmart or something, you know?
Yeah. Like an eye
corporate money.
Corporate eye doctor place.
Megane Super was the name of the company. And they initially wanted to buy UWF, the you know, second version of UWF, which ran between 88 to 91. You know, Akira Maeda, Nobuhiko Takada, you know, Fujiwara, everybody, Minoru Suzuki, Masakatsu Funaki, everybody was in it, and they were running Tokyo Dome, and it, the original UWF was the closest thing to MMA then.
It was the only thing that looked, it looked a lot different because nobody knew what a real fight looked like at the time yet. They didn't know the mechanics.
Not yet. And also it was behind that the idea was, see, Maeda had vision and Fujiwara had vision that they are making professional wrestling a legitimate contest. Or, well, it still worked though, but that legitimate enough where people look at it as a real fight. The idea was that. But the whole professional wrestling was a make-believe, right? make-believe. So I, but it evolved. But their idea was to make their wrestling legitimate as possible. That's UWF. So they eliminated a lot of moves like, you know, bouncing off the ropes or fighting outside the ring or using chairs or, I mean, nothing silly.
No silly and stuff, no comedy.
And not even tag team match. An all single match, like it looked like a competition. Anyhow, what I'm getting, you know, what I'm getting is that the owner, Hachiro Tanaka of Megane Super, thought that was it. You know, like, this is the real wrestling. And it was basically real marked out on it, right? And wanted to buy UWF, but that didn't happen. So somebody said, you can start your own wrestling company, right?
And he put a lot of money behind it.
Oh, millions and millions.
Tokyo Dome show even.
Yeah, like the draw, you know. The funny thing is, I'll get to it, but when you go to Megane Super around the time period, you know, they had stock of this invitation ticket for a Tokyo Dome for free tickets.
So if you wanted a new pair of glasses, you could also get maybe two pairs.
You can just walk in and get that piece, you know, like grab 10 of them, 20 of them, you know? As it was sitting there, and what the Megane Super people was somewhat a victim of circumstance that way. That somebody told them that's how wrestling, you know, wrestling industry draws. No, that's not true. If you're popular, you can, you know, fill up Tokyo Dome, right? But so they were told, you know, well, that when you run a Tokyo Dome, you have to give tens and thousands of free ticket out. That's how they fill up the Tokyo Dome. Didn't you know? It's like lies, right? But that's what they did. Anyhow, they went to buy Keiji Muto first, you know.
Mm.
The Muto, and then they gave me this, and with this, you know, hang. They had the key, you know, for like a real expensive condominium in Tokyo. Look, you can have this apartment, you know. And then, you know, it's like a, just trying to buy out, you know, Keiji Muto's contracts from New Japan. And Keiji Muto, you know, at the time, what he was like, a, still like a 28, 29, mm. and came back from WCW and just having his own run with New Japan. Smart enough to decline that. No, I don't want this. You know. Mm. Then they met with Tenryu and his group. And Tenryu was like a one-man band at the time, you know. And okay, let's make this SWS, Super World Sports, big budget behind it. Tenryu, Tenryu is a man. By the way, English pronunciation is Tenryu, huh? Always.
Yeah, the R-Y-U...
R-Y-U is so hard in English speaking people.
Yeah, I don't know
it's
how to.
Tenryu.
Yeah, Tenryu.
Tenryu Genichiro, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, but the most people, even people like Nick Bakwenko, were saying Tenryu.
Tenryu. Tenryu. I think that's easier. Or, yeah, it's one of those sounds that we don't have an equivalent for in English. It's just a sound.
Right, like your TH sound.
TH sound or R and L sounds. I mean,
yeah, we don't have that in Japanese.
There's nothing like
so,
that. So,
yeah.
It's
yeah.
our so our it's, weakness.
My weakness.
Mine too.
Anyhow, that's a get. So as the Megane Super people went to Tenryu, and he was chosen, and he was all ready to leave all Japan. The thing is, by then, all the actuality, Tenryu and Jumbo Tsura program, like a real strong single match program, 3-year run, it kind of ran its course too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they drew packed Budokan after Budokan after Budokan. You know, so you know, let's go back a couple years that, you know, that there was tag team, Jumbo Tsura and Tenryu, babyface tag team in All Japan, top. Then Tenryu turned heel, basically, in 1987. And then there was your single match, very single, a very important single match program, Tenryu against Jumbo. Jumbo remained babyface, of course, and Tenryu became the strongest heel. You know, well, not quite. In Japan, kind of subtle, mm. right? I mean, not like he didn't turn bad guy or anything, you know, but you turn and, you know, create your own faction, more like. And yeah, well, basically heel. And he became equal to Jumbo. Actually, Jumbo had everything going for him for decades, right? Top guy and all the single match, important matches, titles, championship, and all the winning. And Tenryu was clearly like right underneath him. I mean, Jumbo was so far ahead, according to Bruiser Brody. Jumbo was so far ahead of everybody, I mean, skill-wise, and yeah, and, like better worker than anybody. Anyhow, turning Tenryu made him equal. And actually, Jumbo had everything but popularity. See, when somebody has everything like that, he actually isn't the most popular guy either.
No?
Jumbo Tsura was a top babyface, but he was not exactly the most popular wrestler either. It's kind of weird.
He was a top positioned guy, but
yeah,
not
yeah,
maybe
yeah.
The crowd's favorite, not number one.
Not
maybe.
Yeah, because he was so number one for so long that people almost resented his position, mm-hmm. you know, and back their head.
Is it like Roman Reigns in WWE?
is so protected, mm-hmm. right? Obviously, yeah.
But the fans, yeah. fans.
Well, more like a John Cena.
John
at
Cena,
the beginning. Okay,
like cold and hot.
At beginning.
Yeah.
Yeah, at beginning, yeah. But anyhow, that by having Tenryu, you know, get over so, you know, so much, he's so popular, heel though, but so popular that made Jumbo popular too. Going against each other in single match program. You know what I'm saying? Mm. It's like almost like a chemistry.
Yeah, in some ways they have opposite dynamics, opposite chemistries to each other because of their backgrounds. Their backgrounds are actually pretty different, but both are two templates for the successful Japanese wrestler. One,
oh,
Jumbo
yeah.
is the wrestler's wrestler.
Yeah.
He went to the Olympics. He's yep. a big dude. But on the other hand, there's a different kind of big man's wrestling, sumo wrestling.
Yep.
That's Riki Dozan.
And also...
That's that lineage.
Yeah, that's a father of professional wrestling. Mm. And also Jumbo, college graduate, Olympic wrestler.
Mm.
Then started working All Japan, Giant Baba's All Japan, like your elite.
Mm.
Yeah, was sent to, you know, Amarillo, Texas, and learned the funk style. You know, such elite.
He was very privileged.
He came back.
He was very privileged.
Yeah.
Had a lot of support.
And upon his return, Baba and Jumbo Tsuda became tag team and, you know, they had a tag team program against primetime Dory Funk Jr. and Terry Funk at their prime. I mean, it's everything. It's almost like handed silver platter-ish. Mm. He deserved it because he's so talented.
Mm.
At the same time, yeah, Tenryu is a type of wrestler, you know, like a former sumo wrestler that he started his career when he was 14, you know? Mm. Yeah. His sumo debut was, okay, he was born, okay, Tenryu was born in 1950, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And his sumo debut was 1964. That's like 14 years old,
he's
right?
He's a boy.
Eighth grade, ninth grade, yeah. Oh my gosh. And he had 12-year run as a sumo wrestler. So he actually grew out of it. You know, I mean, grew up with that culture. Not just sumo wrestling, but everything about it. You know, living in the dojo, living in the sumo bear, lifestyle, chanko food. And sumo has its own culture and own value to it. And he carries this sumo-ness. That's the word, you know. Yeah. He has this sumo culture-ish, you know, culture thing. He carried that to this day.
Oh, yeah.
And in a famous interview, he was saying that, the professional wrestling was great, but as culture-wise or like your every the things you do every day and how you look at things and how you look at the world, deep down, he's still sumo wrestler, he said.
Mm.
You know, some of the things you did, you know, between age 14 to 26, that make you, you know?
Yeah, very much so. And sumo was actually a lot more popular when he was, during his time in general, sumo was on TV for the first couple, you know, for the first time when it was getting really big in the 70s and 80s.
Sumo has been always big though.
What I mean to say is that he's lived in the public. He's lived in the public.
Yeah,
eye.
Yeah, yeah.
He had no
and
problems.
And also he was like, there are always like 700 sumo wrestlers in Japan, 700 of them. And 50 sumo bears, you know, only top 40 guys appears on TV every day. NHK, you know, during the summer tournament, which just ended, you know, Hakuho won the tournament and all that.
Yes.
Tenryu was on, okay, when he was 24, he was already in the top 40 sumo ranking.
Wow.
So he was on TV, you know. The reason he retired early from sumo wrestling was that there was a split between two sumo bears, you know, who inherit the sumo. Sumo bears means stable, you know, only 50 bears, 50 dojos in sumo world. And you have to either inherit or you buy the stock of sumo thing and you become that dojo or hairs, you know. Anyhow, that his father figure, sumo bear chief, you know, had this split, you know, and he decided to leave instead of taking sides of anybody. And Tenryu wanted to finish this particular tournament. And there's a 15 dates. If you know the kachikoshi, If you win 8 and losing 7, that's like a win, right? Out of 15 days, he wants to win this tournament and walk out of sumo on his own term, which that's exactly what he did at the age of 26. Then he signed with Giant Baba's All Japan, and his wrestling career was another 40 years, though. In a year between 1976 to 2015. Oh my gosh. He wrestled until he was 65. 40-year wrestling career. Well, 12 years sumo wrestling and another 40 years as a professional wrestler.
That is...
So he, altogether, he wrestled like 52 years.
It's an intense lifestyle. It's just...
That's so, so that he is Mr. Wrestling more so than anybody.
Yeah.
Anybody.
Yes, and... I gotta say, like, there's no sumo in the Olympics, but I gotta say, because of his experience, he's him and Jumbo had not the same experience, but very similar and like rival experiences to make them great rivals, great partners. The ace combi.
Yeah, Tenryu was always more popular, but his run as like a chasing the chasing after Jumbo, because Jumbo was always not above him. Single match meant so much, you know? Yeah. The serious single match. Because Japanese wrestling fans always loved Japanese against Japanese single match on top, right? I mean, seriousness. And it was Tenryu's quest to, win over Jumbo, but therefore he will become number one guy in all Japan altogether. So that was a very exciting time, 88, 89, 90. But even as good as the Jumbo Tenryu program was, if you did that for 3 years straight, I mean, single match after single match after single match, it kind of ran its course. And Tenryu felt that he had to look for something, huh?
Mm.
Yeah, then there was a SWS opportunity, that guy. He run his own company. The only thing was, though, because... the idea Tenryu had was that the reason they are not above Giant Baba and Anthony Inoki was that it's their own company. Anthony Inoki, when he was 31, he was already running New Japan Pro Wrestling. Giant Baba, when he was about 34, that he walked out of old JWA and then formed his own All Japan company, and he brought the network channel Nippon TV Channel 4 with him, and both Baba and Inoki were like your owner, promoter, and a director and producer and a top guy in the ring and the champion, and that's what they were not doing. Jumbo still employee, and Tenryu felt like, he doesn't want to be just employee. Does that make sense?
I see. Yeah, because Jumbo never really had that position ever in his career. He was a wrestler, and that was it.
But top pay, though.
Top paid.
Yeah.
He was
top paid talent, wrestler.
Yeah. Top kind of guy.
Top talent.
But that's what Tenryu would end up doing when he would go on to SWS. And that was short-lived, but he would go on to be that kind of Inoki Baba promoter figure, too.
And the owner of his own company, and also he became essentially the very first true freelancer, free agent. Mm-hmm.
A very successful one too.
Yeah. I was looking at his, not a record, but while he was with Old Japan, he had, he had match against Baba, right? Mm-hmm. He had match against Jumbo Tsurura, or people like Hiroshi Wajima, another former grand champion sumo wrestler. Mm-hmm. And he had a match against Dory Funk, Terry Funk, the Harley Race, the Nick Bockwinkle, the Tiger Jit Singh, that the Abdul the Butcher, that he faced every single name superstars when he was working for All Japan. After that, during the SWS period, he had a single match program against Hulk Hogan at the Tokyo Dome, which was big. Then after that, he secretly signed a one-year contract with New Japan. As an outsider, while he was with New Japan, he had a single match against Inoki, the Fujinami, the Riki Choshu, the surprisingly enough, great Muta, Chono, the Hashimoto, Hase, Kensuke, every single superstar from that era in New Japan, that Tenryu had single match with them.
How about the Riki Choshu match at Tokyo Dome in 93? That was, 60,000?
That was like a second run, though, because when Riki Choshu and his stable was as Japan Pro Wrestling, they were with All Japan. That was a top program. All Japan's Tenryu against Japan Pro Wrestling's Riki Choshu went against each other for like a two-year period. Riki Choshu and Jumbo Tsura only had one single match in Osaka in 1985, and it was 1 hour Broadway. And they never did that again. History, you know, apparently. And at the same time, Riki Choshu and Tenryu always had this exciting single match. They had chemistry. So the New Japan version of Tenryu against Riki, they could do it, you know? It was still exciting.
It felt a lot.
Are you with me?
It felt a lot more like, you know, everybody says that NWO and UWF, New Japan, they have a connection. But I always thought the Tenryu with War in New Japan, or Riki Choshu with his JPW, whatever it was.
Yeah,
that felt more like what NWO did in the mid 90s.
Yeah, because. People believe in different company, you know, company against company has more seriousness, you know? Yeah, because even with wrestling, you know, one has to go down, which they always do. Yeah. It's like in reality, you know, after this New Japan against UWFI, UWFI has business. It went out of business for real.
Disappeared. You know?
Disappeared, yeah. Well, the reason they had that company against company, they were, you know, the company was going down. It's, you know, that's why they took that business.
And remember who won all of those matches that night? It wasn't many of the UWF.
New Japan?
No, it was.
As popular as UWFI was at the time, that whomever's booking it will have the upper hand, huh?
Yeah, and I think it was Choshu who booked that, yeah?
Riki Choshu was like very creative as a booker, you know? People don't give him enough credit, you know? After Inoki left to become a politician, Inoki chose Riki Choshu to be the locker room leader and a booker. I mean, exclusively. You would think Fujinami would take that place, right? Mm-hmm.
I didn't.
I mean, like, I don't know. The leadership, I guess, that Riki Choshu had more, not a locker room popularity, but the people respected him, and the company staff respected him, that he was a locker room leader. Like he was, remember Riki Choshu was college jock?
He was an Olympian as well.
Yeah.
And he was always a leader of something, whether it was in All Japan, he was leading people. And if it was
Ishingun,
and so he, I guess he just had that, that's his attitude.
I mean, like, he reminds me of like a college jock from your fraternity house.
Maybe we could say like Matt Riddle.
Yeah.
I don't know. Well, that's the new jock.
Oh, okay. Oh, no, the jock is more like a football jock.
Ah, okay. So, he's a rugby jock or something like that, yeah?
It was a wrestling team, and he went to Olympic, you know? And also was in the college team in Senshu University, and yeah, he was always in that kind of atmosphere.
And you got to factor that in when we think about it, when he's booking this UWF show, he was never, he wasn't the biggest fan of the UWF style. So we didn't see much of that up until that point. Actually, until it felt like he was out of the booking position.
But he was, I have to give him more credit. He was he was not selfish at all. The booking, the way they booked the match and the finish and all these things, that Riki Choshu was never selfish. He never put himself over that much. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but by 1996, after that G1, I don't really see him. He wasn't in too many big programs. He would be in, you know, grudge match.
Right, was giving, that's Keiji Muto, the Shinya Hashimoto, Masahiro Chono, Hiroshi Hase, Kensuke Sasaki, that Riki Choshu was calling them five top guys we have. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's like he stepped down pretty much, you know.
How about Choshu's, did he have much involvement with the junior division in the 90s?
That was always
Liger. So he didn't have anything. Yeah. He stayed hands off. He said,
No. But he'll look at it and okay's it. Because he's a booker.
Like a Vince McMahon or something.
Yeah. But you had another team. I mean, the whole team for the, you have 15 wrestlers to deal with, you know, when it comes to this junior heavyweight division. And it's always been Liger's, like his lifetime job, you know?
He's the junior's manager.
Manager, and also that he's a performer too, you know, and also that the creative director,
right?
He comes up with stuff,
Jacob,
and he knows so much about division and how small guys work and how they should look, how they should not look, you know. And heavyweight finish and junior heavyweight finish should be very different, don't you think? That's the very reason they have two divisions.
Oh, hypothetically, yeah. That's the thing. I think the style now that we see all over the world is this kind of mix of what used to be junior heavyweight that's just now, you know, everybody jumps off the top rope. Everybody does really fast-paced Lucha Libre style sequences in their matches for a little moment here.
That's what's making them not so special.
That's
though,
right.
You know, you want to be different from anybody else. You don't want to look like anybody else. You have to be very original, you know. In that, Roman Reigns pretty very original. John Cena's pretty original. Last night, Bobby Lashley Goldberg thing. I got excited. Wow, this is gonna be a very believable program, you know.
If they were gonna do any program with the current guys on the roster, I think Lashley is probably the most interesting, isn't it?
Yeah, because they were making Bobby Lashley so strong that open challenge and key three. Oh, yeah, that's a pretty good match. Then beat him right away, right? Then open challenge and then Goldberg. It's like, wow, that's a perfect storyline, you know? And that's making Bobby Lashley even bigger star and more believable.
He's someone...
Well, that's another subject for another day.
Yeah, and especially Goldberg. I think Goldberg's time in Japan is something we should probably touch on eventually.
Eventually. But we're talking about the part two of
part
Tenryu.
Part two of Tenryu, so, yeah.
Old Japan, strong Old Japan run. Then SWS and WAR run. Then he never was publicized, but he was under contract with New Japan and had program with every single superstars of New Japan. And at the same time, Tenryu's WAR and the falling UWFI's Takada, Tenryu and Nobuhiko Takada had a single match too. Remember?
That's right. He did the UWF style.
Point system. Yeah, this is amazing. Amazing, right?
And he did.
I mean,
this was a 90.
Strong, tough guy that he can take all the kicks, all the submissions, like ha, you know. But his Tenryu chop, like your Ric Flair's backhand chop, is a traditional wrestling move, right? But that traditional pro wrestling move is just as believable as what UWF have done.
And even though he did that, he does this style, and then not too long after, he's doing the exploding barbed wire match with Onita.
Tenryu against Atsushi Onita. Oh my gosh, same person, same year.
And it's so amazing.
That's how amazing. Yeah, amazing, right?
He did, but he didn't really.
Yeah, from himself. One extreme to the other.
Totally, exactly. Totally different ends of the spectrum.
Like a big movie to a horror movie splat or something.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then later on, he would go back and do more of that stuff, and he'd be
He has single match against Hayabusa too.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, like in the next couple of years, he had a single match against Hayabusa, and one time he even had the Hayabusa mask on, you know. I mean, that's how versatile he is. And at the same time, he always had single match against Mr. Pogo or people like Kendo Narasaki, or he even had single match against Gray Sasuke. Yeah.
And he never seemed like he had to compromise his wrestling style or his in-ring personality.
He was the same.
Always the same.
He was the same. Yeah.
Always the same.
Then he went back and forth and back and forth. That the WAR, maybe he was not, didn't have enough manpower to run his full-time company. you know, or his own shows as WAR. But Tenryu himself always had position because every company wanted him, like Ric Flair.
Mm.
Ric Flair standing there, so every company wants to bring him over for, if he works that show, that becomes a big show, right?
Actually, I wanted to ask you about Tenryu. He had a couple of matches, pretty big matches with Ric Flair over in Japan, and both All Japan.
SWS.
It was SWS. Did he have any match, or was it just a Ric Flair? Did he only wrestle Jumbo on those late 80s tours? Or did he have...
I think that was Baba's choice, okay. Yeah.
They would...
When they had Ric Flair against Jumbo, I think Tenryu had something like Tenryu against Ricky Steamboat, UN title.
That's right. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. So it's like, they were promoted equal, but in the back of fans, you know, fans' head, you scratch your head, it's always like right underneath. Huh?
Up until he left for SWS.
Right. You need to leave there, you know, to leave your nest. And you have to have your own company or own ring or own TV show to do so. You become, you know, like your own. Yeah.
So
Tenryu was big as a heel, but it was the best thing that happened to him was leaving Old Japan. He will eventually come back, but the greatest thing for him was explore the world. And the Old Japan, up until that point in time, Old Japan wrestler would not really work for New Japan Inoki people. You know what I'm saying?
He was the only one.
Yeah, and then the people were thinking, I mean, as a, maybe like, including myself, see, Old Japan's, Giant Baba's Old Japan style professional wrestling and Antonio Inoki's New Japan style professional wrestling, they were considered two different style. And when you have Tenryu, it kind of got, wow, actually, it was the same. You know what I'm saying?
Kind of, yeah. He's the bridging.
See, like, the reason I'm saying that, when I was a little kid, I mean, as ridiculous as it sounds, when I was a little kid, Giant Baba was wrestling was show business. It's fake. Mm. Antonio Inoki's wrestling was that's real, real deal. A lot of people believed it though.
Yeah.
When I was a little kid, that was the mindset of wrestling fans.
Well, I can only tell you from my perspective. I didn't grow up with it, so I'm growing.
You have maybe better observation. Yeah.
But what I mean to say is, just as an outsider, as an American, I see more of New Japan as a martial arts root, kind of martial arts rooted, Japanese martial arts
oriented.
Yeah, there's something more action oriented and more Japanese, whereas All Japan was the Japanese extension of the NWA.
Yeah, because Old Japan and Giant Baba and establishment NWA, National Wrestling Alliance, had the strong connection. And Giant Baba was the only promoter who can bring in your current NWA world title, I mean, world champion Hardy Race or, you know, whomever had it, Jack Briscoe or Ric Flair to your Defunks to... You know, all the NWA superstars, it automatically goes to All Japan. Mm-hmm. Whereas New Japan, when I was a little kid, they didn't have any famous Americans. They had Tiger Jeet Singh all year long, you know?
Running around.
Which was good. I mean, in general, wrestling fan, general, you know? Not the mania. The ones, you know, who watch wrestling on TV every week. Yes, Giant Baba's, you know, regular opponent was Abdullah the Butcher, and Inoki's regular opponent all year long was Tiger Jeet Singh. You know, and then Inoki came up with the idea, like Antonio Inoki making challenge to Muhammad Ali, right? That the people, nobody thought it would actually take place. But that happened, you know, that happened. Inoki against Muhammad Ali, that made him famous worldwide. And after that, also Antonio Inoki always used prime time under the Giant as big heel. So when Tiger Jeet Singh was not on tour, it was Inoki against Andre the Giant. Andre worked heel, and he actually was a real good worker. Mm. Did you know that?
Especially when he had his matches a little later with Stan Hansen, about 10 years after
that. Oh, that was good. Yeah, oh, good. Yeah, so All Japan, Baba had all the superstars, you know? And Inoki was like more like a Japanese-oriented one-man show, huh?
Yeah.
Because Inoki bring in, you know, some wrestler from America, he beat everybody.
know? There was something about he wanted us to believe how real the pain is in all the shows, and
right. That was a mindset.
And he wanted to
use. So there was like two different products.
Yeah, very different.
But it's both wrestling, though.
Definitely.
So something we skipped by having Tenryu in 1990s. You know, like in the all through 90s into late in 19 into even millennium. Having somebody like Tenryu who had experienced both styles.
That's right.
It wasn't all that much different, you know. Yeah. By then I was older, so I understood.
He did it. I guess Terry Funk did something similar too in the 90s, where he just kind of, but not completely similar, because I feel like Tenryu didn't change himself, where Terry Funk would kind of evolve.
It evolved. Yeah. It's not like smile, big face, biggest baby face, the most famous cowboy Texan in Japan, you know. It's still popular, but he had this another run as a living legend, and he had Sabu single program that he was running. Terry Funk against Sabu was running all through, you know, like all over the United States independent scene as main event. That gave Sabu a very good superstar rub, and he became number one deathmatch guy, and style eventually became ECW.
Mm.
Yeah. So it was like a revolution in its own. Yeah. And if you remember, very first ECW pay-per-view, Barely Legal, it was about Terry Funk.
He was the hero.
Yeah. So that's another run. So Tenryu is kind of similar. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But Tenryu,
he went to his own.
He did anything. He would continue to do any sort of wrestling. And
yeah, had a single match against a women wrestler, Shinobu Kandori.
Oh, that's right.
And yeah, and wasn't even comedy.
No.
He was able to have, you know, volleyball match against this woman too.
UWF style violence.
UWF style violence. Yeah.
So really rough.
Old Japan style, New Japan style, and they had a match against Takada, UWF style, had a single match against Onita, the Onita's world, and later on Hayabusa, the Sasuke. After 2000, he had single match against people like Akebono.
Mm, that's right. Yeah. And during this time too, he went to WWF for two Royal Rumbles, 93 and 94.
With Kitao, yep. Yeah. Another
and WrestleMania 7, yeah. So we would Kitao, yeah, and then he was in the...
Well, WWF at the time didn't give him enough time, you know. If he spent like a quarter of the year and run program and worked Royal Rumble and WrestleMania, he probably remembered him a little bit better, you know. Or had actual program of sort. It was like always guest, you know?
Yeah, photo op.
Yeah. But the Royal Rumble, they had the moment that they briefly touched with people like Ric Flair, Roddy Piper, and Bob Backlund in there, that they exchanged some moves, you know? Mm. I mean, like saying hello, right?
It's a cool way to maybe think about, maybe this could happen. You take the picture, you can fantasize, oh, maybe this could happen down the road. It had that effect, but there was no payoff. It was just, what it was. Well, it was okay.
But also, it wasn't each, you know, WWE wasn't, but Tenryu wasn't. They were not really committed to each other all that deep then. You know? But to be able to have any success with WWE, you have to really come to the States and live there and spend a certain amount of time.
Yeah, you have to live here. You have to have a full excursion.
Yeah. So like not until Taka Michinoku and, you know, Funaki and all these guys actually who moved over there and spent 8 years over there to be on TV.
Mm-hmm.
And it's Nakamura, you know, the
Tajiri.
Kenta. Tajiri was there, you know, but like he lived in Mexico. He worked for ECW, then to WWE. And he spent like 8-9 years in the States. Yeah.
He wrote a book about it.
Different, Anyhow, all around after Millennium, we have to point out that Tenryu came back and worked more in a few more shows with New Japan, and they had match with another generation. Like he had match with Kojima, the Tenzan, the Nagata, the Manabu Nakanishi, that generation. They had Tenryu rub too. Remember?
How about
or even Shinsuke Nakamura and Tanahashi? They even had match.
And right before that, maybe like 10 years before that, there was a moment where WAR wasn't. It kind of started to dissolve, and we saw mm-hmm. Tenryu go over and jump to All Japan, back to All Japan after years.
Right after Misawa and his guys left and created Pro Wrestling Noah, mm-hmm. right?
And he
Pro Wrestling Noah took network channel 4 Nippon TV with them. And everybody thought All Japan was going down. That's when Mrs. Baba picked up the phone and called Tenryu, first time in 10 years or so. And Tenryu said, I'll be there. I mean, like a man's man, huh? Mm. Yeah, he is like, that's how he is remembered. Like, I mean, I don't want to sound like a chauvinist, but like he's like an old-fashioned man's man type, huh?
He's like John Wayne.
John Wayne, yeah. Or samurai. Well, John Wayne's a cowboy, so Tenryu should be big samurai.
Yeah, he could be Mifune or somebody.
Yeah, so it really saved all Japan, though, really, until Muto came in.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, that version of 2002 Muto and Tenryu had incredible single match at Budokan 2.
That was a really special match. Why was that so special? Why do you think that was so special?
I guess it was like a veteran Tenryu against veteran, you know, great veteran Muto with shaved head. I mean, new version of 2002 version of Keiji Muto, another run, because he was almost not gonna come back. You know, he left New Japan and he joined WCW and signed the contract. It was the dying days of WCW. Mm. And Keiji Muto was kind of testing water. Like he might want to move to States and stay, you know? And coming from New Japan and signing contracts with All Japan is like really, really, I mean, in Japan, it's like changing company is a big move, you know?
It's not as fluid as it is maybe in other countries where you can work here and you get another job and people understand.
Yeah, and Japanese people don't change company. That's
right
out
of college.
Mindset, right?
You start out of college and you go to your company.
You want to work there for another 30 years until you retire?
It's your new family.
That doesn't happen that way. Yeah. It doesn't happen that way anymore, though. But that was the like way of life for a long time, huh?
I think that mentality for a lot of people
is still there.
I mean, it's definitely different. It's changed a lot. But I think it's still kind of the common idea. You go to college.
Yeah, and then work for college, and you start working for a big company and become part of that family.
And
right?
You do OJT for like 2 years, and then you just work your way up to the top of whatever you can in the position.
Management or the position or that's like a really like a choking in my eyes, you know. I never did that.
I agree. But that's a like a common
lifestyle. A lot of people do, yes. Yeah, and the fringe benefit and bonuses and all the, that's a safe way to live.
It's very safe because they really do take care of you and they'll never fire you.
Right. Well, that has changed a lot, though, in the last decades or so.
Yeah.
But I know what you're saying. The mentality is still there.
Mm.
Yeah.
So.
But Tenryu is so versatile that we just touched upon his program against Takada or people like Onita or Hayabusa or even Kandori and Akebono, or even had the Naoya Ogawa match. Oh my gosh, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, Naoya Ogawa was kind of fun. Tenryu was always kind of on the pulse of whatever was the hot thing,
the hottest.
He was the first one who was in touch and would connect with the fans because he wasn't connected.
Not so much himself, but the promoter and whomever producing at the time would come up with Tenryu. Because who this person should face? And if this person, rising superstar or the new superstar who they want to sell, that put this person against Tenryu, that's automatic big match. you know.
It's automatic so bid match, yeah. And no one really, because Tenryu is alone. He represents himself. He doesn't represent the company. It's a
big name.
Big name, but nobody really. It doesn't really affect the company really severely if something. If he just leaves, it's like Bruiser Brody coming in and out of a territory.
Right, very much so. Very much so. I was gonna say, yeah.
Where that's very rare. I don't know. That really stopped happening around.
Well, Tenryu is the only one, probably the last one for a long time.
And yeah. We're talking about the Muto match 2002. This was the first time.
Budokan, I was there.
Was doing things I'd never seen him do before, like Frankensteiner off the top rope or Topesu.
He didn't look that great, though.
Oh, but not great.
Because that was saying hello and shaking hands to Muto. That's what Muto does, right?
Yeah, that's right. He said, I can do it too.
Yeah, and then also they were working legs, you know, that, you know, Keiji Muto was using the dragon screw leg sweep into figure four leg lock as a finish, mm-hmm. right? That was like his later version of his, you know, finish. And they worked body parts and the storytelling matches, and they stopped almost like a trend of like a big match oriented Japanese moves, you know. Japanese wrestling isn't just bunch of big high spot and big moves. It's like, look, here's a story, you know, storytelling, traditional, very old-fashioned wrestling match, and that's better than the young people's high-flying match kind of thing. Does that make sense?
Yeah, and they proved they could do that and add some high-flying to it too if they wanted to,
for 5 seconds. Yes, but it's not high-flying big match oriented moves. They only had maybe saved one or two big moves till the end. But it was all about very traditional, who's going to have figure four leg lock type of storyline. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. And the big moves feel that much bigger because they're not a big part of the match.
Yeah, they don't do it too much. Yeah.
It's just a memorable
one after
part.
Another. Yeah, it's like a big match. Yeah, I mean, not a big match, but the big move and the big high spot and just a whole bunch of spectacular thing, one after another. And pretty soon, it doesn't mean anything.
It's like the final action scene in a movie. It's not the last part of the movie, but it's just the final action scene in the story.
Yeah, and I always make this reference, like it's going to some, you know, expensive restaurant for lunch and you had big buffet. You know, there's so many different items, but you don't remember what you ate today. It's like a big buffet. I mean, too many items, you know. So you don't need that many things on your plate to have great dinner. Just two or three nice things, you know? So at the end of the day, it was meat and potatoes and veggie. How's that?
Yeah, good combination.
Yeah, yeah, and soulful. I mean, like a soul hot.
Comforting. You
know? Yeah, and that's what you needed, you know?
Especially at that time. Actually, that's a good segue because we have to also talk about Tenryu in his brief stint in Hustle. I remember him.
Yeah. Yeah. That was like a dark, I mean, I talk about dark period of Japanese wrestling. It was so dark that when I think about it, it's already 15, 16 years ago, like 2004, 2005, 2006. Mm-hmm. I really felt that the wrestling business as a whole was going down. You
it's
know?
Like a bad dream.
Oh, a bad dream. And weekly fight. Weekly Gong, they all went out of business, you know. And then three or four, those newsstand newspaper, you know, sports papers that we talked about, they went out of business. And things are going to all internet, but not all journalists migrated to internet, you know, the category either. So it's like all new people, and this all happened all at the same time. The internet. Not just the internet, but that they started having the moving picture on the screen within the internet. So that would change television and that would change DVD, you know, and all these things. Everything was changing. And Tenryu was not exactly in his prime time anymore, but he was still on top, age 60 or something. Mm. But he was still in the ring. And that's when I said about Naoya Ogawa or people like Akebono, you know, and or he had match. He was in the same ring with people like Takayama, you know? Mm-hmm.
That's right. Yeah. And he would have
all new era.
He would show up in Pro Wrestling Noah in the early 2000s as well, have matches with Misawa, Kenta Kobashi.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So he was always relevant.
Relevant, of course. Takayama was the greatest, was going to be the greatest candidate to be like Tenryu.
Mm, you know? I could see that, yeah.
Mm-hmm. If he didn't get hurt, you know?
Takayama was a big, big guy. We should talk about him sometime too.
Yeah, yeah, I spoke with his wife not too long ago. Yeah, that he's in a rehab, you know, the facility still. But after COVID, I cannot visit him at this moment.
Oh,
yeah,
really?
Because you know, other people will be, you know, infected, or you know, the whole building is very controlled. You
I
know,
see.
That only immediate family, not even the immediate family, can go there. You have to register and make an appointment.
You know? I see.
So I text, you know, her, you know, when can I, you know, come and visit? That please text me again, you know, back and all these things. I used to come and visit maybe every 3 months or so. Yeah. Hmm. We sat and just talk wrestling, of course. he grew up as a big wrestling fan. No secret about it, you know. So we talk about a lot of wrestling. It's just fun.
And he was on the undercard of those matches that Tenryu had with Takada back in the 90s. He was one of those UWF.
When he debuted with UWF International, that he was still one of the undercard young guy, huh?
Short hair.
Yeah.
Short part hair.
Always tall.
Very tall.
Yeah.
Really, it really stood
Almost
out.
Almost skinny.
Yeah, lanky, yeah. Lanky. Yeah, he got very big towards his end.
I think he surpassed Takada after that.
I think so.
Yeah, and also Takada went to MMA and he was never able to come back.
No, you know? He was.
Then when he came back to when Takada came back to traditional style professional wrestling, it was more of a definition of hustle.
Mm.
And of all things, Takada was wearing Hitler costume. Bad. Remember?
Yeah,
Takada was Hitler costume.
And Tenryu was he was wearing some kind of costume as well.
Pants.
He was wearing the army pants or
black pants. Yeah,
dancing.
I think he had to have this, you know, that the back, what do you call it, like a big corset that you know, he was all taped up. You know, his knees to lower back to all these places, and he was leaning forward like old person. And but when he goes into the ring, he can do it. Then after that he even made appearance and he had a brief match against this generation of Shinsuke Nakamura or Hiroshi Tanahashi or Katsuyori Shibata. They touched each other in the ring all the way to, remember his retirement match in 2015, the very last match Tenryu had was against Kazuchika Okada.
Mm-hmm.
So all the way from Giant Baba to Kazuchika Okada, he faced it. You know?
And that was on kind of his own
show.
Like
that.
He was like his own. It wasn't any
promotion. Retirement show. Yeah.
That's something that
right?
doesn't really happen either. He didn't need a promotion.
He ran
him.
His own
yeah.
show. No. That when he had this retirement ceremony and his very last show, that's his own show. Actually, his daughter ran. It was a promoter.
A Tenryu project. That she's in charge of that.
Yeah, and they still run Tenryu project. To this day.
Mm-hmm.
They just this last weekend, Tenryu Project had a show, you know, and Tenryu comes in, of course not gonna wrestle, but he comes in with his cane and watches the show. Oh yeah, before I forget, Tenryu, as of last week, it was very interesting. Tenryu banned thigh slapping super kick at his show.
Oh, that is big news. He announced that publicly?
Yeah, because no, he told the boys.
Yeah.
Told the boys.
So
I mean,
that's
what you guys are doing is great, but the one thing he hates or dislikes so much that every time somebody throws super kick, that shouldn't make sound. You know, I mean, maybe once in a while, you know, thigh slapping will be really spectacular, right? It's like, oh, connected, it hurts, right? But every single time, every single wrestler does this super kick, this shouldn't make any same sound. So thigh slapping thing is no at his show. Interesting.
Huh? I heard a very similar story at Katsuyo Shibata has dojo. And
oh, told New Japan Dojo, don't be making noise. That's not necessary.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, he said if he catches his guys doing the thigh slaps, that's 100 squats for the students.
Oh, okay.
He told me. Okay. Yeah, I'm dead serious. That is straight from the horse's mouth. That is.
Yeah, well, he's like that. He's like
old
that.
School.
Yeah. Very old school. Well, maybe once in a great while, that should work. But not every time you do the super kick or anybody does a super kick. Mm. It shouldn't make that much sound.
I've never heard anything right? like that. We've heard, because we know what they sound like now. It doesn't sound like Crow Cop every time.
No. It probably doesn't make any sound. It just looks devastating. Yeah, it's like a sound effect, you know, so it's a different mentality, you know. And a lot of the young generation's wrestlers don't even know what it meant, you know, until they were told, you know. They just thought that's what they do, right? Like, but coming from old-fashioned wrestler like Tenryu or younger, but Katsuyo Shibata, it's like, don't be doing that. It's like, that has to be told, you know. They wouldn't know it until they were told. How's that?
And when I think of Tenryu, I think of he would do something that's the total opposite of making a noise. I remember him getting so much reaction from he would like to chop some of his opponents in the throat. Do you remember how he would do that? He would chop them kind of illegal, but he would do it in the throat.
Yeah.
No noise, though. It was just how he did it. It's kind of his answer.
Well, communication
to that.
Or the potato to your receipt or, you know, wake up. You know, but usually his Tenryu chop, you know, much like your Ric Flair's backhand chop, that's like that makes a lot of noise.
A lot of noise,
you know?
Every time.
Yeah, every time. For real. You know how inner bleeding, you know, that your vein killing, just devastating. It turns red, then it turns purple. Mm. Bleeding inside.
Sometimes outside too.
Yeah, that too, yeah. But that's also a Japanese, you know, very tradition of, you know, their own style, I think.
And he finished against Okada, the top star, you could say is the top star still.
Yeah.
Of his time. So how many, that's four decades.
I mean, like somewhat 35 years younger than he is.
Yeah, could be his father.
Yeah, I think so, yeah. But he wanted to walk out and finish his wrestling career with somebody that's like today's biggest superstar. And also that day he made sure he had this original black short trunks and the black and yellow old ring boots. Mm-hmm. No more pants, you know. He had this 65 year old Tenryu come out with short black trunks, old-fashioned black and yellow old ring boots. He worked like, I mean, he can't do it, but that's how he wanted to look.
And his natural body shape.
Yeah. And then also, before we forget, we have to point out that his last protege, the guy who was carrying Tenryu's bag, Tomohiro Ishii, became big superstar.
Ah.
You know, with New Japan. Mm-hmm. Because he was always told he's too short to be anything, right?
That's right.
And then proved the world wrong. Yeah, Tomohiro Ishii is one of the biggest, you know, favorite star. Not top, but makes difference to have him on the card and how popular he is in at the building. You know, Ishii, you know, he's popular.
And
right?
He's very much the same spirit as Tenryu.
Tenryu, and very believable. No gimmick, no promo, you know.
Self-made
man.
Just
goes out. I think so. So a little bit of Tenryu is still out there. Yeah. Yeah, that's what I'm getting.
And I see that a little bit in Shingo Takagi, too. Do you see that as well?
Yeah, I guess
maybe
so.
Just taking some of the style, you know, the backwards elbow drop and the mm-hmm, goo punches mm-hmm. and the backwards chops.
Goo punches, yeah. Well, lots of clothesline, though. I mean, almost too much of clothesline, my taste. But he comes from Dragon Gate. But he's more old-fashioned, and the first dojo or first gym he worked out, you know, he learned was Animal Hamaguchi's gym. Mm. Yeah.
When he was, in high school?
Right out of high school, before Dragon Gate. Mm. he came to Tokyo and joined Animal Hamaguchi's dojo, where people like Kojima or Otani or so many different guys came
Naito.
Out. Yeah, right. So it was like a dojo before dojo, you know?
So he has that kind of lineage sort of too and connects.
It's very important.
So,
yeah.
I think we hit all the high points of Mr. Tenryu's career, Mr. Puroresu's career.
Think so? Yeah. Very good.
I'm happy we didn't have.
Yeah, because if we don't talk about him, he should not be forgotten. Today's wrestling fans, I don't know the younger generation listeners out there for our program. Yeah, we should always learn the people from the previous generation. Much like learning about Tenryu is much like you're learning about Ric Flair or Hulk Hogan, or you know what I'm saying?
He's one of the what can we say? He's on the Mount Rushmore.
It's so easy to say icon. It's like so abused. You know, the word icon is so abused. So it's like, or legend or something like that. But it's hard to say he's one of a kind.
But he's really special because he doesn't really have an exact contemporary, and he lived through a lot of different eras, and he didn't stand in the shadows during those eras. He was right out in the spotlight, from Hustle to the UWF times to the Deathmatch times to showing up in the States when he was younger, when he was more of his prime.
Yep. And actually, his English is pretty good too. Well, his voice is but more English speaking than he lets out. You know,
he's a very interesting character, and he's still here, putting on his own show.
He's still here. And as of last week, he banned a thigh-slapping super kick.
He's still active.
That's pretty good.
He's still
in the world. Don't be doing that at his show, under his watch, you know? That's interesting, huh?
I think so. Do you have any, if you had to recommend one match for a listener out there, what would you...
Oh,
if
wow.
If you could just type it in on YouTube, what would the first one that comes to mind? What opponent or match that comes to mind?
Early 1990 Jumbo Tsuda single match, one any of them, there were about 7 or 8 of them I can come up with, but any of these Jumbo single matches good. And Keiji Muto single match 2002, that was? Yeah, that's must. Mm. And any Tenryu against Riki Choshu or even the Ishingun tag team, Tenryu and Ashirahara tag team match, any of those, they're all good. Mm. Different era, different wrestler. It's kind of like 70s, late 70s Ric Flair match, early 80s Ric Flair match, WWF era Ric Flair match, back to WCW Flair match, long hair Ric Flair, short hair Ric Flair. It's really a lot of them, right? So it's the same as Tenryu. You know, you can't point out one or two.
So everyone out there that's listening, just you have to do your homework on your own. There's too much to do.
Yes.
If you know, type in this. I'll link up some of these matches.
I'll
put it in the notes when we post it on Patreon.
Sounds good.
So where can people find you on the internet?
On Twitter, Fumihiko Dayo, FumihikoDayo, Fumihiko Dayo on Twitter, or just Fumi Saito on Facebook. Message me first.
Mm. Send a message before you add. And I'm at Justin M. Nipper, KNIPPER on Twitter. If you have any questions or if we missed anything, let us know. Let us know in the comments on Patreon or via social media. And I think next time, we talked about this earlier, but I think we're going to leapfrog over to Mr. Jumbo Tsuta. Yeah.
We have to.
Because we're kind of in the zone anyway. Sure. We're in the zone.
Oh, yeah. It's a completely different path.
But
he became college professor at the end.
Mm-hmm. Out my way, out in Oregon.
Yes, that's right.
So,
that's right.
But a very different route than Tenryu, but it was at the same time.
Very much so. But they were actually good friends too. Yeah.
And they both went to America too. So yeah, we'll get to that. We'll get to that next time. But I guess until next time, Fumi, take it away.
So long from Tokyo.
Write that down, Fumi Saito.